you don't own me.
Let's go. But I'm Gerald, and I can always have just what I want. She's the baddest, I would love to flaunt. Take her shopping, you know Yves Saint Laurent. But nope,
Hello everyone. Sorry. And welcome. It's a new video, it's a new series, it's a new topic. Exciting stuff. Now, today's going to be a bit of a weird one, because I've decided that my next proper series is going to be on parasite biology. I'm going to do 5 videos on parasite biology as part of my revision. Now, today isn't going to be about that at all. In fact, we're going to be doing something completely different. We're going to be doing some insect biology today. Now, insect biology, or entomology, if you like, is a big, big subject, and I don't think I'd have time before my exam to cover everything. So instead, I'm going to do, I'd say, the biggest topic of them all, and that is insect evolution. And it's kind of dipping our hands into loads of pies here, because we're bringing everything together. A lot of the biology we know on insects, we've got to apply here in order to build a whole tree of life to describe how different insects are related to one another, okay? So it's going to be a big one. But before we talk about insect evolution, we need to talk about where the insects themselves came from, okay? Now, we know that insects are in the phylum Arthropoda, okay? And this is by far the biggest group of animals on the planet. In this video, we're going to be talking about most of the animals, or even most of life as we know it. Okay, because the arthropods are so bloody diverse, okay? So, before we start talking about insects, we need to start talking about some of the non-insect arthropods, because there's quite a few of them knocking about as well, okay? So let's go through there's 3 major groups which aren't insects, so let's go through them and talk about their key features, okay? Now, the first one is the chelicerates, or the class Chelicerata. I've done some bullet points here to make sure I know what I'm talking about. Now, the chelicerates include the ticks, the mites, the scorpions, the harvestmen, the pseudoscorpions, camel spiders, horseshoe crabs, all these sort of things, and of course, the true spiders. And this is a tube web spider, which I found in Bath about 6 months ago now, and I've had it in my room ever since. At this point, I'd like to say, if there are any arachnophobes out there, it's coming for you! Now, the chelicerates are mostly terrestrial. You get very few marine chelicerates. And there's 2 major subclasses. By far, the most famous one is subclass Arachnida. That includes basically everything. The true spiders, the scorpions, the ticks, the mites, all that sort of thing. There's another group called Meristemata, which includes probably some of the weirdest groups of animals on the planet. They're the horseshoe crabs. Now, these are marine, okay? But they do rely on land, because if you see off the coast of America, these huge scale migrations of these horseshoe crabs back to the sites, the beaches where they lay their eggs. So they do rely on a terrestrial environment for a key part of their lifestyle, okay? The body structure of a chelicerate is completely different to that of an insect. Of course, in an insect, you've got your head, your thorax, and your abdomen. Okay, if you look at my tube web spider here, you can see there's only really 2 segments. Yeah? Can you see them? There's this bit, the top bit, which is a fusion of the head and the thorax. It's called a cephalothorax, right at the top here. And the bottom bit, which is sort of mushed up a little bit in this specimen, that is the abdomen, or more technically, the epiphysoma, okay? Now, the whole group is defined by its mouth parts. They're called chelicerates because on the head, the main jaws are a pair of what we call chelicerae, okay? And these are big jaws that come off the second segment of the head, which pierce tissue and release digestive enzymes which digest the spider in this case, the spider's food from the inside out, and then the spider then sucks up all the digesting material like a milkshake. Delicious, right? That is pretty well known now after detailed molecular analysis that the pair of chelicerae are derived from the same basic compounds that the antennae are, as we see in the insects, and also a lot of the other arthropods that we're going to be discussing. Okay, so key point is that chelicerates don't have antennae, they have chelicerae. Okay. Also, a clear distinction to make here between these and insects is that the position of the mouth. In insects, it's found between segments 3 and 4. Here, it's found between segments 2 and 3. Nice little detail there. Also, we've got to talk about the limbs, okay? And this is going to be a key feature that we're going to be talking about throughout the video. The limbs of the chelicerates are described as uniramous, okay? Now, we're going to expand on that in a little second for now, because we're now going to move on to our second class of arthropods, and these are the crustacea. Now, in contrast to the chelicerates, these are mostly marine. They include the things like the lobsters, the crabs, the barnacles, all that sort of stuff. Freshwater crayfish. The most important, I guess, terrestrial species of crustacean is an animal which you'll find absolutely everywhere, and they're the woodlice. So they're real experts at colonising the land. They've come from an aquatic lifestyle, moved on to the land and adopted a terrestrial one. But of course, if you've ever seen a woodlouse, which I'm sure you'll have, you'll often find them in damp places. So they're pretty, you know, reliant on water, humidity, in order for them to function, right? Now, there are also differences in the amount of appendages on the insect head. In an insect, you have a pair of antennae, a pair of mandibles, a pair of maxillae. Here, the crustacea have gone a bit greedy. They have two pairs of antennae, one pair of mandibles, but also two pairs of maxillae. Of course, the maxillae are used to sort of handle the food. The mandibles are used to sort of bash away at it, breaking it down, whilst the maxillae keep it there, also do a bit of cutting, but are also very useful at handling the prey item, right? Now, here, we do have a biramous limb, as opposed to the uniramous limb of the chelicerates. Oh god, I've dropped my papers! So this can be called biramous or polyramous limb. Basically, it means more than one. Right? What we mean here is that on the basal segments of the limb, so, I don't know, this is going to be terrible, but that's your coxa, this is your trochanter, that's your femur, tibia, tarsus, right? Now, here, on the final segments, we have other structures attached. Okay, that was very poorly drawn. And these can be called a whole load of things, but in this case, we're going to call them excites, right? Aren't we excited?
Okay.
And these excites can be modified in a huge number of ways, right? Now, in crustaceans, we see appendages on most of the segments on the thorax and the abdomen. Because if you look at the abdomen, usually you see gills, for example. In this case, these excites can be used in things like filter feeding, reproduction, etc. Okay? Right. Our third and final non-insect class of arthropods. These are the myriapods, and these are the centipedes and the millipedes, okay? Or more properly, chylopoda, centipedes, diplopoda, the millipedes, right? And like the chelicerates, these are also terrestrial, and they also have uniramous limbs, like the chelicerates and the insects. Now, I bet you've always wondered, how do you tell the difference between the centipede and the millipede? Well, they're quite easy to identify, but don't mean to be a snob or anything. And the basic rule of thumb is that centipedes have one pair of legs per body segment. Millipedes have two pairs of legs per body segment. There you go. So now when you're walking through the forest and you spot a myriapod, then you can tell instantly whether it's a centipede or a millipede. Fantastic. Like the crustacea, they have two pairs of maxillae. Okay, remember, insects only have one pair. So after covering these, we can see that there are loads of shared features in all these arthropods, which make them a group. right? So, let's give them. They all have an exoskeleton, yeah? Made up of cuticle, chitin and protein mixed together, forming a glycoprotein matrix, which is useful for loads of things if you live in a terrestrial environment in particular. They have metameric segmentation, okay? The body is divided up into segments, and those segments in turn are divided into what we call tagma. This is tagmatization. So in the case of insects, we have a head, a thorax, an abdomen. Yeah? Three clear tagma. We also see periodic molting, that's the process of ichthyosis, the shedding of the exoskeleton. We also see segmental jointed appendages, of course we do, just talking about all those limbs and antennae and mandibles and maxillae, all that sort of stuff. We all have a single body cavity, so if you were to dissect an insect, it would all be sort of one big cavity where all the stuff is, all the major organs are. And this is called the hemocoel, right? They all have compound eyes. Well, kind of. A lot of chelicerates do not have compound eyes. In fact, most don't have compound eyes. But all the other classes do. And lastly, they all have a brain. There's cephalization going on in the evolution of arthropods. And they all have a ventral nerve cord running down them, which is obviously very useful. Right, so they're all the similarities. Now, it's pretty well accepted that the evolutionary ancestor of all arthropods was some marine polychaete-like organism, right? A good living example is this species, which I'm going to read out, Hesionoides arenaria, okay? And this is a pair of protruding structures on each segment. And they're also covered by a layer of cuticle. But however, that's as far as it goes, basically. They don't have any jointed limbs or anything like that. How do the various classes of arthropod that I've talked about actually fit together? Well, there are actually loads of living polychaete-like species which give us an idea on how arthropods may have arisen. And the two key ones are the Onychophora and Tardigrada. Now, the Onychophorans are a group of really weird creatures. Here's a picture of one now. Their common name are called the velvet worms, and there are about 100 living species today, although they're way past their heyday. They reached their peak around 500 to 600 million years ago, when they were much more abundant. Now, these little creatures are segmented. Most living species are terrestrial, but they do tend to live in rather humid, wet, moist environments. So they are dependent on a good water supply, right? And all the fossil species we see, or most of the fossil species we see, do appear to be marine, okay? Now, Tardigrada, their common name are called the water bears, which is a cool name. These are small little creatures. You've probably, you know, you need a microscope to see them properly. Now, these are largely aquatics. Remember, there's the dependency on water. They have a cuticle, but no jointed appendages. And that was the case for the Onychophorans as well. Okay, you can see in that picture that I showed you, little protrusions, but there wasn't any jointed appendage going on there, right? That was obvious. Now, the first proper link we see with the true arthropods are the trilobites. Now, these are long extinct clade of animals. Here's a picture of one, right? And here you do begin to see a lot of arthropod features coming in. They peaked in the Cambrian explosion, which was around 440 million years ago, but they died a terrible death relatively soon after that. So rest in peace, trilobites. So these are mostly marine, and they were detritivores. So that means they scavenged and fed on dead matter on the sea floor. Okay, they came to quite large sizes. And like I say, they're abundant 500 million years ago, but these did have jointed appendages and also biramous limbs. So I think we can safely consider these to be arthropods, right? The transition between arthropod and non-arthropod occurred somewhere between the evolution of the tardigrades and the Onychophorans and the trilobites. Now, there's been a big debate on whether the arthropods are a polyphyletic or a monophyletic group. Okay, so remember, polyphyletic from more than one ancestor, monophyletic from just one, right? So, if it's polyphyletic, maybe that the different arthropod classes, the Chelicerata, the Insecta, blah, 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 diverged so early on that there isn't really any link between them at all. And this was something which was argued by the entomologist Sidney Manson, who strongly argued that the arthropods were a polyphyletic group. Okay, and her argument was that it's all to do with the exoskeleton. Now, the exoskeleton is very useful, but it constrains the organism, right? So many of the features that we see in all these arthropod classes are associated with this exoskeleton. So many of these, all these features in common we see in the arthropods might have been derived just because they all have an exoskeleton. So it could be a case of convergent evolution going on here. Now people have further divided arthropoda into many other groups. So people call insects and the myriapods Unirema, because insects are thought to be quite related to myriapods. The insects and the myriapods and the crustacea are called mandibulata, as opposed to the chelicerata, which don't have mandibles. They of course have their chelicerae. Now new molecular tools are casting new light on the evolutionary relationships between these classes. And through all of this analysis, it is now actually pretty much conclusive that the arthropods are in fact a monophyletic group. And this here is the kind of phylogeny that we see. Now there are loads of different types of phylogenies out there. There's huge diversity. And that's because each one is looking at a different part of the genome. Right, okay, so it all gets a bit complicated, but this is one which could be right, it may not be right, but we're pretty sure it's right. Okay, so here we have our polychaete ancestor down at the bottom, then coming off here we have the non-arthropods, we have the onychophora and the tardigrada. At this point here where I put my black line, we have the arthropod ancestor. Okay, and coming off it, we've got a trilobiter, which obviously the line is shorter than the others because they've buggered off now, they're extinct. But all the others aren't. So then you've got your Chelicerata, Myriapoda, Insecta, and the Crustacea right at the end. Now the general consensus now is that this crustacean root, as shown in this phylogenetic tree, is basal for all arthropods. Okay, so all arthropods, from this point onwards, have a crustacean-like ancestor. And when you think about it, this kind of makes sense. Remember, crustaceans with their biramous limb? All these other clades, well, except the trilobites, don't have biramous limbs, or polyramous limbs. Another point to make here is that crustaceans, as I said earlier, are mostly marine. Your lobsters, your crabs, and all that stuff. Okay? Now, during the time where we think all these different clades radiated was a time when the earth was starting to dry up, right? So more land was becoming available, vegetation was growing, you know, on the land. So there was a move of these crustacean-like organisms onto the land, okay? So that gives you your insects, your myriapods, and your chelicerata, which began to dominate the land. And that explains why we don't get many marine insects, right? Because the insects have moved from the marine environment, from being crustacea, onto the land. So you get some marine insects which have secondarily evolved to go back to the marine environment, right? So there's always exceptions that sort of prove the rule. What isn't clear is whether the chelicerates, the myriapods, and the insects diverge separately from that root. We know that the myriapods and the insects are actually closely related, so it's likely that maybe the myriapods should be here, okay? Further along the insect branch, okay? So we're not really sure. A whole load more molecular work needs to come for us to gain our perfect phylogeny. So therefore, we can say that the biramous limb of the crustacea is a primitive feature, because in all the others, it's just some sort, somehow been absorbed back into the body and used to maybe have a different function, of which we're not really sure yet. There are some examples where we could get a bit of an idea. For example, the maxillary palps on the maxillae could have been derived from the biramus limb. And also in the diplopodes of the millipedes, that extra leg on each segment may have been derived from an exite, right? But the actual mechanism of this and how we could get natural selection towards this sort of thing is, it's a bit up in the air. We don't really know. Okay, so that's the big picture now. So let's focus in to our most important group of arthropods, the insects. Well, I say focus in, it's still a pretty big group of animals to deal with. But anyway, now on that last phylogeny that I had on the board, what I should have done on where the insects diverged, on that line, I should have drawn another two lines of two other groups, which are sister clades to the insects, okay? And together, they're called the hexapods, because they all have six legs, right? Now, the ones which aren't insects because they don't have any external mouthparts. They're also called entognatha, right? That's the name of the group, the primitive hexapods. Okay, and they consist of three clades, the Procura, the Columbula, and the Diplura. And these are three rather inconspicuous, small-looking creatures which you find in dirt. Basically, if I'm honest, not particularly exciting. The Columbula, other common names are called the springtails, and they are vital soil organisms, right? So, as I say, they're mostly terrestrial and feed on organic plant material, and that's why they're such useful animals. So you mustn't take them for granted, a little bit dull, but get over it, they'll do their job. Now, there's a key feature we've got to talk about in the development of these arthropods from now on, okay? And there's two words that we've got to get right.
Okay.
That's anamorphic and ametabolous development, and these are all features of these primitive hexapods. Okay. What I mean by ametabolous development, to start off with, is that after every molt, because remember, these arthropods, they have a cuticle, they have to shed their cuticle in regular molts. After every molt, there is no change in body form. The animal looks exactly the same as it did before. Okay? That's the first bit sorted out. What I mean by anamorphic is to grow, they add a body segment each time. So there's addition of body segments and the organism gets longer and longer. Okay, so that's anamorphic. So that's a feature of the Procurans. They're anamorphic. The Columbula and the Diplura are slightly different. They still undergo ametabolous development. However, these are epimorphic. There isn't a continual adding of segments. There is just a general, increase in growth, okay? But it's not done by, a prosaic addition of body segments each time. Now, just to give you a date on the hexapods diverge from all other arthropods, we think, approximately about 400 million years ago, okay? So that's endognatha. Let's now talk about ectognatha, the main group, basically the insects. Okay, and these diverged from the other primitive hexapods around 300 million years ago, we think. Right, around then. And what separates these guys from the entognathans is what? Ento-ecto. Gnatha means mouse, right? So the ectognathans have external mouthparts, okay? And there's three main groups, really. There's the Archaeognatha, the Thysanura, and the Pterygota, right? Now, the two most primitive, of course, are the Archaeognatha and the Thysanura. The Archaeognatha are bristletails, Thysanura are silverfish. And I actually found a silverfish on my floor this morning. Oh, it was destiny! I knew I was making this video! So here's a picture of my silverfish. Beautiful little creature. Now, what are the features of these two groups, the Archaeognatha and the Thysanura? Well, we see weak tagmatization. There's no real clear distinction between the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. There is a bit, but not as much in really advanced insects. Yeah? They tend to live in damp vegetation. The silverfish used to be a really common animal in households, but since the invention of central heating, households are less damp. So it's the environment isn't as good for them to survive anymore, okay? So if you're gonna judge me on the dampness of my house, then go ahead, you know? I've had a tough life, you know? Sometimes it's hard. Another thing we see in these two groups is that we often have styles on each of the body segments. There's a little small appendages, right? Now what about the development of these? Well, these are also ametabolous. There's no addition of body segments, so they're epimorphic, but there's ametabolous development. There's no change in body form. Okay, now, another thing, when you think of insects, you think wings, okay? That's one of the key features of all insects. They're the only invertebrates to have developed powered flight, okay? These guys are different. They don't have wings. They're the only groups which don't. And they're both wingless, so because they're both wingless, we put them under subclass Apterygota. Wingless, basically, okay? So that means the other group are the pterygotes, okay? The winged insects. And of course, these are the main guys. This is what we want to talk about, right? So, let's talk about the main groups of insects. Ooh, how exciting! Right, we're really getting down to business now. We're going to start off with the first group, the Paleoptera. As the name suggests, these are the primitively winged insects. So these are the oldest insect orders that are alive today. Okay, and there's two main ones. So, there's the Ephemeroptera. These are the mayflies, okay? And as their name suggests, you'll find them in this country around May time. They have aquatic lifestyles. They live down in freshwater lakes and rivers as nymphs. And at a particular time in May, they'll emerge from the water. But there's actually a very interesting part of their life cycle which has loads of applications, which we're going to talk about in later in the video. Mayflies, when they emerge from the water, so they'll emerge from a nymph into an adult, okay? And then once they've emerged, they'll fly off onto the bank and then they'll molt again. Now usually we'd expect a larvae to molt into an adult and then that adult will mate and then die, right? Well, this pre-adult stage in mayflies is absolutely unique to this order, the Ephemeroptera. No other insect order does this. So it's really quite fascinating. And also in the mayflies, you can see in this picture, the wings are held above the body. There's no really any wing folding going on here, which is something you see as insects become more advanced, okay? So you want to protect your wings so you can move about in small crevices and whatnot and not get them damaged, okay? So it's very important. Okay, the other major group are the Odonata, the dragonflies and the damselflies. The dragonflies are in a group called the Anisoptera, and the damselflies are in a group called Zygoptera. And you can see in the damselflies, the main way to tell the difference between the dragonfly and the damselfly is their degree of wing folding. Dragonflies have their wings, you know, right stretched out across the body, where damselflies have them. They're a lot more, you know, dainty, if you like, they're a lot more slender, but they also have their wings folded up when they're at rest. And as you may have seen, they are superb flyers, and they're ferocious predators, you know, scanning around, zooming about lakes and ponds, catching insects. And they're also just as much of a great predator in the air as they are in the water, where they spend their nymphal stages, okay, where the nymphs predate on, you know, everything from beetles, tadpoles, even small fish, right? Okay, so that's our first group of insects, the Paleoptera, which consists of the Ephemeroptera and the Odonata. Now we have the Neoptera, the new winged insects. These can be divided into two suborders. They're the Orthopteroidea and the Hemipteroidea. Okay, so let's take a little gander on what's in each one. So here come the pictures. So the Orthopteroidea consists of the Orthopterans, believe it or not, which are the grasshoppers, locusts, and the crickets. Okay, so that's what gives the group their name. They also consist of Blatodea, which are the cockroaches, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. We've also got the Dermaptera, the earwigs, those horrible looking creatures, yes? They also the Embioptera, which is a bit more an obscure group. They're a group of insects called the web spinners. Okay, not very common, very small, you're very unlikely to have seen them. And then of course there's the Isoptera, which are absolutely fascinating, form huge colonies. They are the termites, okay? And obviously the termites have polymorphic body forms due to the different social castes. So they're an incredibly interesting group of insects to study. Another group that's in the Orthoptoidea are the Phasmatodea, which include the stick insects, the leaf insects, all that sort of stuff, and the Mantodea, probably one of the most amazing groups of insects. These include the praying mantises. Okay, the Hemipteroidea then. These include the Hemiptera. No surprise there. And these are the true bugs. Now, we're very used to calling any creepy crawly a bug, especially the Americans. They're like, oh, G-man, look at that bug. Yeah? They're wrong. They're complete idiots. True bugs are something completely different. Their key feature is their sucking mouthparts, which they drill into plants to get at their sap. Okay, so the bugs are a specific group of insects, okay, and they include things like the aphids, the shield bugs, the leaf hoppers, the cicadas. And in contrast, the Orthopteroidea have chewing mouthparts rather than sucking mouthparts, so that's why we've got these two groups here. You know, a lot of it is based on, you know, morphological features such as the mouthparts, but of course there's also been extensive molecular data going into all of this. Okay, so what else is in Hemipteroidea? It's not just the Hemiptera. We have some more obscure groups, so the Thysanoptera, the thrips, they're sort of like elongated termites. Once again, very small, live in damp soil conditions, you know, you very rarely see them. And we also have the two types of lice. We have the Socoptera, which are the bark or book lice, okay? And then we have the Therapteroidea, okay? And these are head lice, okay? And I must say, I've never seen one of them before in my life. I mean, I don't know whether they exist. Oh. Okay, so that's the Neoptera, consisting of the Orthopteroidea and the Hemipteroidea suborders. Okay, now the Neoptera and the Paleoptera, which of course included the Ephemeroptera and the Odonata, these can be grouped together in what we call the Exopterygotes. Okay, and these have distinct patterns of development. Now, in all the patterns of development we talked about before, we've just talked about ametabolous development. Okay, so that means after every molt, there's no change in body form. The insect looks exactly the same every time it molts. Okay, here we see something completely different. Here we see something called hemimetabolous development. And this is where we see a change in body form after successive molts. Now, there's an important point to make here. The juveniles of the Exopterygote are called nymphs. Okay, nothing else? They're called nymphs. And after each molt, there's an appearance of external nymph buds. Okay, and these will eventually become the wings when the nymph eventually molts into an adult. Okay, we've all seen a beautiful film of a dragonfly emerging from its dragonfly nymph, you know, cuticle. Okay, it's a beautiful sight. Now this is called incomplete metamorphosis, and I'll explain why it's called incomplete metamorphosis when we contrast it with complete metamorphosis, which is in our last main group of insects. Of course, we're talking about the Endopterygotes. Now these really are the real deal. They contain most of the most abundant insect groups on Earth, including the Coleoptera, the most abundant insect order. And I have one here. This is a mealworm beetle, Latin name Tenebrio molita, and it is a Coleopteran. What a beautiful thing. So if you've ever fed mealworms to the birds in your garden, this is the creature it's coming from. They are the larval stages of this mealworm beetle, which can actually be found across the UK in the wild. So therefore, beautiful thing. She's called Anna, by the way. The other major orders, well, there's the second most abundant order, the Hymenoptera. They include the bees, the wasps, and the ants. So a lot of social insects going on there. You also got the Diptera, which are the true flies, like house flies, crane flies, hover flies, mosquitoes, all this sort of stuff. The Lepidoptera, and I've also got some Lepidopterans here. These are the caterpillars of the painted lady butterfly, which is a native butterfly species to the UK. And we can't really see a lot of them at the moment because they've actually started to move right up to the lid of this container here because they're about to start pupating. And the pupa is something which we're going to be talking about a little bit later. Right, and we've also got some more, a bit more weird groups. We've got the Mecoptera. Now these are probably one of my favourites. These are scorpion flies, and look at them. Don't they just look awesome? They're awesome. I'm not having any away. Right, and we've also got the Siphonaptera. They are the fleas, so another bit for pain, okay? But probably the four most popular insect orders in there. So let's talk a little bit about endopterygote developments and why they're different from all the other ones we've talked before. Well, the exopterygotes, we said, had hemimetabolous development. Well, these guys have holometabolous development. Now, you may have noticed that I referred to these caterpillars as larvae, okay? That's because all endopterygotes lay eggs which hatch into larvae, not nymphs. Okay, and that's all to do with this holometabolous development. And this is complete metamorphosis. That's another word for it. Okay, so in this life cycle, an egg hatches into a larvae, then into a pupa, then into an adult. And in that pupal stage, all the internal organs of that insect get broken down and then rearranged into a completely different body form. Okay, so that's the difference between a larvae. In a nymph, it's a juvenile stage where it looks pretty similar to the adult. Here, when you look at that caterpillar, that looks nothing like the painted lady butterfly it's going to turn into. Okay, so that's why it's holometabolous development. Now, you do get some weird little exceptions, okay, because there's, you know, the variety of insects is so vast, there's always going to be some insect which is going to, you know, go against the rule, the exception that proves the rule. Now, in Diptera, when they pupate, they actually keep their larval cuticle, their last larval cuticle, around the pupa. Okay, so we can't technically call this a pupa, we actually call this a puparium. Okay, so this is in the Diptera, the true flies. Okay, in Siphonaptera, which are the fleas, when the adult emerges from the pupa, it actually stays within the pupal casing until it's stimulated by, I don't know, heat or vibration, and then it'll emerge. So that's a reason why if you leave a house unoccupied, say a damp house with loads of fleas in it, those fleas will stay dormant in your house, inside their pupal casing, until someone enters, you know, that extra warmth, they'll sense that warmth and that vibration you give by moving about, and that's when they'll become active. So you can get suddenly sudden massive outbursts of fleas in your house if a house has been left unoccupied for a long time. Right? Okay, so very interesting. So the big point here is that, you know, makes the endopterygotes completely different from all the other insects we talked about, is this pupa. So for the last bit of the video, we're going to be talking about how this pupa evolved at all. Where on earth did it come from? Okay? Now, there have been some suggestions. Remember the Ephemeroptera that we were talking about, the mayflies with their pre-adult stage? There have been suggestions that the pupal stage may have evolved from the pre-adult stage of mayflies, okay? Which sounds pretty logical, seeing as though no other insects on Earth except the mayflies have this pre-adult stage, okay? Now, once this is established, then the endopterygotes and the exopterygotes can follow completely new, different evolutionary pathways, okay? So maybe that's how they diverged. But there is absolutely no evidence to support this, okay? A lot of the things in entomology we simply do not know, and this is one of them. However, there has been another hypothesis predicted which has a little bit more evidence towards it, okay? Now, on the board, we've got three different life cycles. So on the top, we have our hemimetabolous life cycle. So here we have an egg, which hatches into a nymph, and this will molt through. Here we have two nymphal stages, and then eventually into an adult, okay? In a holometabolous insect, we've got an egg developing into a larvae this time, not a nymph, and then that will pupate, so it'll molt into a pupa where all the internal organs are rearranged, and then it'll become an adult, a nice beautiful butterfly, which, you know, all our childhood memories, you know, of keeping butterflies come from, right? Now in the middle here, we have the life cycle of the proposed common ancestor, right? So here, we have an egg followed by two larval stages, then followed by two nymphal stages, then into an adult. Okay, so it's sort of a mix between the two. Okay, now, what the suggestion is, there is some evidence for this, because if you look into orthopteran, so the grasshoppers and the crickets, then you can see very brief larval stages in the unhatched egg. So the larval stages occur within the egg, and these are extremely brief, okay? At most a couple of hours, okay? So they molt very quickly, and then the egg hatches and you've got nymphs. So we may have these very, very brief larval stages in hemimetabolous insects. Now on the contrast, in holometabolous insects, it could be this nymphal stages which turns it into the pupa. Now, however, there's very little evidence for this, except from looking at the pupa of many endopterygotes, because the morphology is quite similar on the exterior to the nymphs of hemimetabolous insects, right? You often see, you know, signs of wing casing and wing buds developing, etc. So it's thought that the pupal stage is derived from the nymphal stage of the exopterygote ancestor. But, as I said a thousand times, it's very up in the air. We don't really know. Maybe this pre-adult stage hypothesis is more believable. Oh, God, we don't know! We need answers, man! We need answers! But anyway, that's all I've got time for today. God, that was a lot, wasn't it? But thank you very much. I'll be back with a parasite series soon. Hope you enjoyed that. See you later.